what? Kick cancer's ass. As presenters of this study, our aim is to identify the relevance of periodontal disease and colorectal cancer. Determine if colorectal cancer accounts for greater risk for periodontal disease. On the subjective part of our quiz, shown on the screen is our patient's dental chart. As for our demographic data, JVM is a 26-year-old Filipina, married, born on December 5, 1992, a Roman Catholic residing in Lemery, Batangas. For the medical part, our patient complained of 6 episodes of vomiting and epigastric pain of 1 week duration. For the dental part, patient complains of inflamed gingiva, where she mentioned, namamaga yung bilagid ko madalas. For the history of present illness, for the medical part, 4 months prior to consult, patient experiences abdominal pain characterized as cramping. 9 over 10, located in the mid-epigastric region, occurring regularly. No interventions were done. 3 months prior to consultation, patients still experience abdominal pain but now associated with nausea, hematochezia, bloatedness, difficulty in defecation, and weakness. Patient was admitted in Batangas for 3 days and was managed as a case of peptic ulcer disease. 2 months prior to consult, patient still had abdominal pain 9 over 10 with the same characteristics as before. She was rushed to the ER in Batangas, wherein ultrasound was done which revealed gallbladder polyp. Patient was advised for surgery but refused. 1 month prior to consult, patient was diagnosed with UTI and was given unrecalled antibiotics. 8 days prior to consult, patient experienced the same abdominal pain, hence was rushed to Batangas ER, wherein DRE was done, which revealed a rectal mass. Biopsy was done. Patient was advised surgery while waiting for results. 1 day prior to consult, patient had 6 episodes of vomiting and epigastric pain, hence the consult. For the dental part, 1 year prior to consultation, patient noticed that her gums bleed when she brushes her teeth on both upper and lower arches. Also, she noticed plaque accumulation on the lingual side of her mandibular anterior. Patient did not seek dental care to address the problem. 6 months prior to consultation, patient noticed that her posterior teeth is slightly drifting towards the missing space. Her gums still bleed as she brushes her teeth. Patient still did not seek any dental consultation. 5 months prior to consultation, patient noticed having halitosis and rough areas on her lower anterior teeth had increased. Patient's gums appear swollen and red and still bleed while brushing. Upon consultation, patient presents with the same symptoms as such as bleeding gums when brushing, foul breath odor, and swollen gums. For the past medical history, patient's childhood immunizations are complete but not updated. No history of past hospitalizations, no history of trauma, no history of any surgery. For the dental part, extraction of the lower sixes in 2008 and haven't undergone oral prophylaxis. For the patient's family history, his father had arthritis, her mother had goiter 23 years ago and was left untreated. Patient had 4 other siblings and all with no known systemic disease. For the personal and social history, patient worked as a cashier at a local grocery store for 1 year. She and her husband are currently residing at a farm. Patient does not exercise nor consumes alcohol. Patient is a non-smoker and denies the use of illicit drugs. For the review of systems, the patient has no complaints. For the objective part,
general survey, patient is awake, alert, ambulatory, and not in cardiorespiratory distress. Patient is oriented to person, place, and time. is responsive and talks in an orderly manner. He's also well-dressed for the weather and properly groomed. For the vital signs, blood pressure is 110 over 70 millimeter mercury. Temperature is 36.8 degrees Celsius, pulse rate is 83 beats per minute, and respiratory rate, which is 18 breaths per minute. For the anthropometric measurement, her height is 151 centimeters, weight is 43 kilograms, and BMI of 18.9, which according to WHO standard and Asian criteria value is normal weight. For the physical examination, for the neck, normal. Extraoral examination, symmetry of the face is symmetrical. There is presence of TMJ pain and sound. Swelling is absent, no cracks or fissures, no ulcers. Upon lip examination, lymph nodes are not palpable and the facial profile is straight. For the intraoral examination, the patient's oral hygiene is fair. Pink gingiva, consistency of the gingiva is firm. No elevations, depressions, or color changes. The tongue is normal, and the occlusion is class 3 type 1 edge to edge. For the thorax, cardiovascular and breast, normal. Abdomen, genitalia, normal. Rectal, extremities, musculoskeletal, normal. For the assessment, for the medical part, there, according to the patient's chart, there is a rectal mass of 70 centimeters FAB. RO malignancy, status post colonoscopy with biopsy. For the dental, multiple dental caries on tooth number 1716, 1514, 242526, 2737, 4547, and missing teeth 36 and 46. For the plan, diagnostics for the medical part, complete blood count with PC sodium, potassium creatinine test, and blood urea. Some people with colorectal cancer become anemic because the tumor has been dealing for a long time. That's according to American Cancer Society. Chest x-ray should also be done, wherein this test aids in identifying if the cancer has spread into the lungs. Colonoscopy, this test checks the entire length of the colon and rectum using a colonoscope. It is inserted through the anus and into the rectum and the colon. Biopsy and removal of any suspicious lesion can also be done with a colonoscope with the aid of special instrument. CT scan, this test uses x-rays to make detailed cross-sectional images of the body. This can help in identifying if colon cancer has spread to the neighboring organs. MRI, or magnetic resonance imaging scan, shows detailed images of soft tissues in the body. It uses radio waves and strong magnets instead of x-ray. A contrast medium called gadolinium is injected to clearly see the details. PET scan or positron emission tomography scan uses a form of radioactive sugar that is put into the blood. Cancer cells are more likely to take up larger amounts of sugar than normal cells. And the rectal ultrasound, this test uses a transducer that is inserted through the rectum. It is used to check how far from the rectal wall the cancer has grown and whether it has reached nearby organs. And for the dental part, complete mouth radiograph series or CMRS and pocket depth probing according to FDI World Dental Federation. For the therapeutic plan, pharmacologic, according to the patient's chart in the medical part, omeprazole and Dolphin. For the dental, analgesics, mouthwashes containing paracetamol as according to medscape.com. For non-pharmacologic therapeutic plan for the medical, surgery, radiation therapy, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, immunotherapy as per National Cancer Institute. And for the dental, oral hygiene instructions, oral prophylaxis, restorations of caries teeth, and fabrication of posterior FB. And for our expert's opinion, first, when it comes to assessment, exhaustive examination is necessary. Complete radiographs, including CMRS, panoramic radiograph, and biting radiograph, must be done. All present ulcers should also be noted off, including possible sources of future ulcers and possible sources of ulcerations like ill-fitting dentures. So, removable denture fitting and readjustment should be done, or otherwise, remove them na lang as they may cause traumatic ulcers if the mucosa, in the mucosa, and etc. This is according to Dr. Maria Erica A. Lantayan. Continuation. In peri cases, as much as possible, resolve it immediately. If deep scaling is necessary, it has to be carried out immediately. After which, oral hygiene maintenance is done. Clorhexidine mouthwash is recommended. So, colorectal cancer is a cancer that starts in the colon or the rectum. These cancers can also be named colon cancer or rectal cancer, depending on where they start. Colon cancer and rectal cancer are often grouped together because they have many features in common. If cancer forms in a polyp, it can grow into the wall of the colon or the rectum over time. The wall of the colon and the rectum is made up of many layers. Colorectal cancer starts in the innermost layer of the mucosa and can grow outward through some of all the other layers. When cancer cells are in the wall, they can grow into the blood cell, blood vessels, and lymph vessels, and from there they can travel to nearby lymph nodes or to distant parts of the body. For the signs and symptoms, the highlighted parts are the ones manifested by our patient, which is a change in bowel habits, a feeling that you need to have a bowel movement that's not relieved by having one, rectal bleeding, blood in the stool, cramping or abdominal belly pain, weakness and fatigue, and unintended weight loss. And additional, for lifestyle changes, eat a variety of fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. Drink alcohol in moderation, if at all. Stop smoking. Exercise most days of the week and maintain a healthy weight. This is according to Maya Clinic in November 2018. For the video, we already posted it in the group. So our chosen journal is entitled Periodontal Disease, Tooth Loss, and Colorectal Cancer Risk, Results from the Nurses' Health Study by Fatemi Momin Herabi et al., published by the International Journal of Cancer on the 25th of October, year 2017. So our objective is to identify the pathophysiological to identify moderate or severe periodontal disease as a risk factor of developing colorectal cancer and to determine the potential role of oral health in colorectal carcinogenesis. And for the researchers' objectives are to identify the pathophysiological mechanisms of periodontal disease that may possibly influence colorectal carcinogenesis and to identify multivariable adjusted hazard ratios and confidence intervals for tooth loss and periodontal tooth loss in relation to colorectal cancer by using Cox proportional hazard models. So according to CIRCL 2014, colorectal cancer is the third most common cancer in the USA and often arises within the context of increased inflammation and altered immunity as well as changes in the gut microbiota. And according to Chan, E.T. et al., the plasma levels of certain inflammatory biomarkers or pro-inflammatory cytokines such as soluble tumor necrosis factor receptor 2, interleukin-8, and interleukin-6 were associated with an increased risk of colorectal cancer in some but not all studies. And according to Mayers, the two most commonly used measures of oral health are periodontal disease and tooth loss, wherein periodontal disease is a chronic inflammatory disease of the supporting tissues of the teeth, while tooth loss is the main manifestation of persistent periodontal disease. Having said that periodontal disease is a manifestation of a poor oral health, and a poor oral health might increase systemic inflammation, which may lead to a local, overly aggressive immune response and potentially alter gut microbiota by pathogens that cause periodontal disease, which could have an important implication for colorectal development. For the methodology, the study populations were from the respondents of the Nurses' Health Study. The Nurses' Health Study is an ongoing prospective cohort study of 121,700 female nurses aged 30 to 55 years in 1976 living in 11 states in the U.S., namely California, Connecticut, Florida, Maryland, Massachusetts, Michigan, New Jersey, New York, Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Texas. Since 1976, the participants have completed questionnaires regarding information on medical history and lifestyle factors and newly diagnosed diseases every 2 years. For the assessment of periodontal disease and tooth loss, periodontal disease was first assessed in 1988 and where it was defined as a history of periodontal bone loss. If a periodontal bone loss was reported, the validation was done by obtaining radiographs from subset of individuals with and without self-reported history of periodontal disease. In 1992, about the number of natural teeth remaining, which ranges from none, 1 to 10 teeth present, 11 to 16 teeth present, 17 to 24, and 25 to 32 teeth present were collected using a questionnaire. The questionnaire was validated by medical and dental records or radiograph review in the health professional's follow-up study. For the assessment of other colorectal cancer risk factors, information on height was obtained in 1976. In 1980, alcohol consumption and other dietary factors such as intakes of folate, calcium, and vitamin D were assessed and using a validated semi-quantitative and food frequency questionnaire. Information about risk factors of colorectal cancer such as adult body weight, physical activity, cigarette smoking, history of colonoscopy screening, and family history of colorectal cancer were collected through biennial questionnaires. And participants were asked in biennial questionnaires to report a diagnosis of colon cancer. When colorectal cancer was reported, medical and pathology records were obtained to confirm the incidence of colorectal cancer. So for the statistical analysis, the researchers used the 1992 questionnaire as a baseline for number of teeth analysis, and as a baseline for periodontal disease, the 1998 questionnaire was used. To estimate the age and multivariable adjusted hazard ratios and confidence intervals, Cox proportional hazards models were used. For the results, the pie chart shows that among women with information on both number of teeth and periodontal disease in 1988, 3,079 of 12,245 or 17% of the participants have less than 17 remaining. 2,652 of 15,150 or 18% are those with 17 to 24 remaining teeth, and 5,638 of 46,457 or 12% are those with over 24 remaining teeth had periodontal disease. Thus, tooth loss and periodontal disease were partially correlated and provide different information on oral health. The graph shows that women with fewer teeth, which ranges from 0 to 16 or less than 17 teeth at baseline, were older and more likely to be past or current smokers and have type 2 diabetes, but had lower intakes of alcohol. A greater proportion of women with history of periodontal bone loss had ever smoked compared to those with no history of periodontal disease. Also, alcohol consumption was slightly higher in women with history of periodontal bone loss. So for the results, compared to women with 25 to 32 teeth, women with less than 17 teeth were at higher risk of incident colorectal cancer with a hazard ratio of 1.20, 95%, with a confidence intervals of 1.04 to 1.39. When considering severity, women with moderate or severe periodontal disease were at a suggestively higher risk of colorectal cancer, with a hazard ratio of 1.22, 95%, confidence intervals of 0.91 to 1.63, compared to women without history of bone loss. And when jointly considering the number of teeth and history of periodontal disease, none of the results reached statistical significance, except that individuals who had both history of periodontal bone loss and less than 17 teeth had a significantly higher risk of rectal cancer, with a hazard ratio of 2.20, 95%,
and a confidence intervals of 1.05 to 4.63. For the conclusion of this study, women with less than 17 teeth and those who have moderate or severe periodontal bone loss were at a modest 20% higher risk for developing colorectal cancer. Significant positive association was seen for proximal colon cancer but not distal colon cancer, and consistently appeared to be stronger for rectal cancer. For the dental relevance to dentistry students, since most cancer treatments include chemo or radiation therapy, it is important for us to know that for patients who will undergo radiation therapy and the location of the cancer is neighboring the oral cavity, the oral cavity will be deemed along the line of fire. All wounds within the oral cavity has to be given time for healing first before proceeding with radiation therapy. And there is a higher susceptibility of caries and oral lesions due to xerostomia secondary to the treatment. And dental relevance to hospital dentists, knowing the background of a certain disease, like this patient with cancer, hospital dentists must be able to diagnose well and give proper treatment for the patient. The dentist's role is to draw the attention of health practitioners to the impact of oral health on the general well-being and to emphasize the need for deeper interaction between medical and dental training. And for our expert's opinion, according to Dr. Maria Erica Landaya, if my presence of extensive caries lesions that would call for an RCT, normally in an exonogen, especially if the procedure would take too long or several visits talaga, tapos di ma-assure yung proper seal of the canal and coronal portion. In cases that may periapical lesions, extraction is also done. If multiple extraction of adjacent teeth, make sure to do alveoloplasty and never leave sharp bony spicules. For resto, I don't think there is any specification as to use of composite or amalgam, but it is best to take radiographs also after doing the restoration to ensure intact fillings. For sound teeth, do sealants if possible in order to lessen the possibility of caries formation during the time of chemotherapy, most especially if the patient is to undergo radiation therapy and the location of the cancer lesion is neighboring the oral cavity, and the oral cavity will be deemed along the line of fire, meaning mahahagib ng radiation as in cases of head and neck cancer. All wounds within the oral cavity has to be given time for healing first before proceeding with radiation therapy. So basically, the treatment plan must be done wisely and efficiently in order to start the treatment of the existing cancer. You cannot treat the cancer without doing complete rehabilitation of the patient's oral cavity. Remember that during chemotherapy, only emergency dental care should be carried out, no anything elective. And we end our report by saying, but seriously, get screened, know your risk, doctor, doctor.